Kathy is a botanist and plant and habitat specialist for the Idaho Transportation Department with over 22 years of service there. I've known her for about 15 of those years and always appreciated her expertise and enthusiasm. At ITD, Kathy oversees the roadside operations and maintenance programs, including revegetation, native plants and pollinator habitats, and noxious weeds and invasive species management. Prior to ITD, she worked at the Bureau of Land Management in Boise for 10 years in revegetation, plant ecology and monitoring, and noxious weed control. And she graduated from Boise State with a major in biology, emphasis in botany. Her professional memberships and affiliations include the Idaho Noxious Weed Control Association, the Idaho Invasive Species Council, and the Idaho Nursery and Landscape Association. She's also a member of the Transportation Research Board Committees and an advanced master gardener in Kenyon County. She's been involved in a half acre pollinator garden at an ITD rest area and has a native pollinator garden at her home. So please join me in welcoming Kathy.
Thank you so much for letting me come here and talk about one of our research projects we just finished up this summer. And among all of the other things I do, this was one of my most favorite projects I had. So I'm happy to share that with you. So I had a project, research project with Montana State University and the Western Transportation Institute. Back, I'd say at least a couple, 3 years ago, we were concerned about the monarch listing coming up and what kind of habitats the pollinators needed, specifically monarch, but also other pollinators such as bumblebees and bees. And I said, we need to figure out what we have on our roadsides because I have no idea. I mean, I drive them all every year. I go to different places around the state, but I don't know where all our milkweed patches are. I didn't know what kind of other plants pollinators were looking for and how can we be a part of this. So this was the research project that we had going on for the last couple of years.
Just for a moment, we gotta figure out, we forgot we didn't turn the lights off. So give us a moment to get the lights off and maybe to see the animation a little bit more.
So for this presentation, I'm going to talk about the pollinator programs that were in place and coming about. We're going to talk about our monarch and milkweed study that we did, and then also look at the bee, butterfly, and flowering plant communities. And then also part of this project was to help us make recommendations for our management techniques within roadsides. So some of the pollinator initiatives that were coming out about the time we were talking about this was the Pollinator Partnership Plan, Action Plan. This was initiated by President Obama at the time, where he wanted to create a team of folks to look at a federal strategy to promote better health of honeybees and other pollinators through creating partnerships. So the emphasis on this was looking at partnerships and agencies that can work together and working through a strategy and a commitment to saving honeybees and pollinators. Then we had the Midwest Association for Fish and Wildlife Agencies, or MAFWA. MAFWA was Mid-American Monarch Conservation Strategy, which included right-of-way agencies and their contributions and how we could reach a regional approach and implement strategies and goals. And then we also had the transportation rights-of-way. So this particular focus on transportation and utility right-of-ways came about through the Obama years. And they were identified as important resources for the monarch butterfly and pollinator habitat across the country. So state DOTs managed roadsides that had over 17 million acres across the U.S. And so they focused on what can transportation and utility right-of-ways contribute and provide for pollinators. So why is it important to study roadsides for pollinators? Well, pollinators play a critical role. So pollinators contribute to several different crops that are produced in the nation here. And then we have different pollinators, insects, butterflies, and other things that pollinate these crop foods. We also know that insects are declining globally. So in Germany, they have a 76% decrease in flying insects. And Puerto Rico is published that they have anywhere between 78 and 98% decrease in insects over 36 years. And then we have pollinator habitat, which is increasingly rare. And this is a photograph of a site in Idaho and what it looked like back in, you know, the early 80s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and then what it looks like now. So we have parts of our habitat are being fragmented and changing over the course of years, dependent upon the agricultural industry and what kind of crops and things people are growing. And so it plays an important role, and it's very crucial in our habitats. And roadsides can provide pollinator habitat across ecoregions if they're managed effectively. So roadsides can be that ecological part of the missing puzzle. So roadsides can help connect the fragmented pieces that our agricultural or other managed lands are depleted or don't have. And so we want to look at how can roadsides play and help with this whole picture. And at the same time, when you're just looking at roadsides, they present a lot of different dangers or negative effects when you're thinking just pollinators. You think of right-of-ways and how they're managed. We have mowing activities. We have spraying for noxious weeds or invasive species. We have all these different toxins from the cars that travel our road systems, whether they're heavy metals, whether they're exhausts or tire dust, noise, turbulence, or sodium levels from our de-icing materials that we use on roadsides. And of course, we also have collisions with vehicles. So how do we go about figuring out how can we help with the whole thing? So that started this research project. So we wanted to find out some information. So we know that pollinator populations are poorly understood right now. We don't have the data that shows the reproduction or mortality rates, excuse me, along roadsides or with vehicles. We don't have population data across space and time. Excuse me. So all these things are important. Sorry, I got a tickle in my throat. And, excuse me. We need to look at what are the costs and what are the benefits. So for roadsides, some of the costs can can be higher traffic volumes, toxins on our roadsides, poorly managed or timed activities. But roadsides can also be a benefit. They can provide floral resources. They can provide woody stems or woody vegetation. They can provide bare soil. They can provide food for a lot of different pollinator during their growth and migration and going from the instars to the butterflies or their mature stages. So roadside habitat depends on several factors. We have, of course, the right-of-way management, the different activities that happen on roadsides. We have traffic levels. We have sizes of the road systems, including distance from the vehicles traveling on the roads to the outer fence line or outer parts of the road right-of-way. And then we have vegetation and floral resources. So this is a diagram for the monarch butterfly. It shows the migration patterns from California up into Idaho, both in the spring and the fall. And you'll notice that for monarchs, when they come into Idaho, they all leave Idaho and they go back to California coast where they overwinter. So monarch butterfly populations have plummeted since the 1980s. There's been 95% reduction of the monarch population in the west of the Rockies. So the monarch butterfly was listed as an endangered species, proposed listing through the Endangered Species Act in December 2020. And the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service is going to be reevaluating that and determining whether the monarch is going to be listed in 2024. The migratory monarch butterfly was also listed as endangered by the IUCN in July of 2022, but it's been downgraded or listed as vulnerable right now. So it's still a vulnerable species. It's still a species that's in decline. And, it's one of those things we need to really pay attention to monarchs, because it's not just the monarchs that's endangered. There's a whole list of pollinator species of bees and bumblebees that are also coming up through the whole chain of warranted for listings. So we think about the monarch butterfly, and it's probably the most iconic butterfly that we know of here. It may be probably the most iconic insect species worldwide. I mean, a lot of people know of the monarch butterfly. And we've raised the caterpillars in our classrooms. We plant the milkweed plant, the host plant for the monarch, in our gardens. And we can, we can gauge and count their populations, where they fly, and track them along the way. Yet monarchs are disappearing, and we don't understand exactly why. And there's so many different factors contributing to that. We don't know what's the most important one, what's the major one, or how can we change that course? So think of it in the 1980s when people started recording and documenting monarch butterflies. If we look at back in the 80s and 90s, and this represented the total population of monarchs, this is what we have today. We have a fragment of that whole population from the 1980s of what we have that's being found and documented today. So milkweed, Milkweed is the plant that the monarchs need to survive, to regenerate, to repopulate, and to fulfill their migratory and reproduction status. We know that we have at least 6 native milkweed plants here in Idaho, and each state has a listing of all the different native milkweed plants that they have for each state. And it's the only plant that monarchs lay their eggs on and that their larvae can feed on to get them through those stages to become an adult butterfly. And these are just some of the other insects that utilize the milkweed here in Idaho. So where is milkweed located along Idaho, in Idaho? And can existing models accurately predict milkweed patch size or distribution along our roadsides? These were some of the questions we wanted to know and we wanted to figure out through this study. So we conducted an assessment along Idaho's major road systems within the Snake River Basin area, which is the southern part of Idaho, goes from the Oregon-Idaho border, follows I-84 through I-86 and I-15 over to the eastern side. We covered 910 miles in one direction, and then we turned around and looked at it going the other direction. So we covered like over 1,800 miles. And we recorded every location that milkweed is found in our road system, in our right-of-ways. For areas that had more than 50 stems, we stopped and we collected more data. We collected the size, the stem count, the density. We collected other floral resources. We looked at terrain type. We looked at adjacent land use and dominant species within the right-of-ways. And then from this assessment, we mapped out where all these populations of milkweed occurred in our right-of-ways. So everything in blue or dark blue, purple, are areas where there's been milkweed patches within a right-of-way system. So, kind of the thing that we wanted to touch on here was that, you know, anything that had 50 stems or greater, we took more in-depth reporting and collections. So we had a lot of milkweed occurring through Idaho and between Caldwell and all the way into eastern Idaho. And the other thing to note here was that, you know, and we started this study in 2021, and within the year 2021, our weather patterns and our dryness and the way that the precipitation panned out, we entered into a dry spell. And when you compare that with the data from our 2022 years, it was like 100-fold of what we were experiencing. And with milkweed, within flower plants in our right of way, it was very, very night and day. So this is showing some of the what we classified hotspots or places that had large densities of milkweed within Idaho. And you can kind of see from this map and the circles, they're focused around Twin Falls area up near Idaho Falls and Rexburg. These were our densest collections of milkweed that we recorded everything all the way from Rexburg over to Caldwell, but these were denser patches of milkweed within our right-of-ways. And then everything in the yellow was less dense or less thick in patches, but they're still there throughout that whole system. So, and this is just showing the patches that we wanted to show between, you know, the less dense up to the thicker or denser. So when looking at what data we collected and what we observed, we wondered whether or not existing milkweed models could predict milkweed distribution within our roadside systems. So we looked at the modeling that the Idaho Fish and Game had put together, and they looked at several different factors for modeling milkweed and monarchs. And we compared our data with the data that they had. And they looked at top five factors for modeling for milkweed and monarchs. It was elevation, soil depth, the mean temperature range, mean precipitation within the wetter months, and distance to perennial water. And when we looked at our data and compared it with that, we kind of see a little bit of where our data kind of fit in with that. And yet we found some places where along our road systems, there was milkweed, but it wasn't really, it didn't fall into that modeling. So there was a little bit of differences there, but we could glean from that modeling and figuring out, well, where does our data from roadsides fit in? So you can see these two circles were areas that we found milkweed that fit within that modeling. And then we have these other areas that were kind of dense, but they didn't quite fit with all of the modeling predictions. So looking at that data in the modeling, it did really predict modeling patch size or distribution within our road systems, but there's a lot of reasons why that it would be. I mean, we're looking at a modeling over a landscape, and there were those five factors you had to take in consideration for that. And then we're trying to fit road systems into that. And sometimes our road systems don't match that because our road systems are not necessarily in the best wet regions or have the best wet months that happen at the right times or whatever it would be. But what could we learn from that? So what we found was that roadside milkweed kind of touched along all of those factors, but there wasn't one factor or anything that said, this is the way it is, and this is where you're going to find it. So it touched on all of those. Distance to perennial water, presence of soil depth, you know, precipitation in the wetter months, and the mean diurnal temperature ranges. We found milkweed in all of those areas, but it wasn't a predominant factor for roadsides. So the milkweed modeling assessment, you know, it captured all of those factors, but it wasn't consistent. It wasn't like, oh, that those factors are the only things that are going to show you and all the milkweed is going to show up. It wasn't just that. So what we found was that milkweed found along roadsides, the biggest factor that showed up for every milkweed patch was the distance to perennial water and the proximity to irrigated agriculture, which kind of makes sense with roadsides because you drive the roads that in Idaho and you're passing agricultural land. I see all the time where their irrigation sprinklers are going and they're going over their land into the right-of-ways and they're watering some of the wider right-of-ways. You know, so the biggest factor for us from right-of-ways was the distance to water or proximity next to water. So this is just kind of showing you that that's the main thing for roadsides is how close is it to water or a watering source or a collective watering area. So roadside milkweed is found near high water tables, wet soil, standing water. It's found near ditches. It's found near canals and places where it draws in the water. And it's common more common towards the edge of the right-of-way or the fence line where it borders adjacent land, but it's also found up near close to the pavement and concrete road system. So this slide is showing you the data that's collected on where monarchs are found, or at least through in Idaho. And what we found for our road systems and our right-of-way was that monarchs are really rare to find in a road system. You know, in the total of a 2-year project, we found 7 adult monarchs, we found 3 larvae and 1 egg within our road system. And most of that was in the 2022 year, nothing in 2021. This is actually what we found in our road on the milkweed plants that were growing on our right of way in 2022. So they do occur in right of ways. They do occur in landscapes adjacent to right of ways. So we wanted to know some other questions. We had other questions. What is this? What can we glean from this? So we wanted to look at what kind of pollinators, bees and butterflies and plant communities have to do with right-of-ways. And do any of those have, can we figure out, are any of these things relevant to pollinators, and how can we promote these things that are pollinator friendly and pollinator, you know, collaborative, you know, grouping of things? And what can we do to focus on bringing habitat that's suitable? So we looked at pollinator or patterns for pollinator diversity and abundance across our road systems. We looked at factors associated with these patterns, prioritizing pollinator friendly management, and what kind of data can we glean from this, and how do we make it work better? So we're going to go look at each of these types of things. So we looked at our management regimes, so mowing, spraying, and plantings. We looked at, you know, traffic levels. There's different road systems that have heavier traffic, like our interstates, than some of our state highway systems. We looked at the size of a road system, so the distance from the pavement to the fence line, and then different vegetation and floral resources that are out there. So how do bee and butterfly species richness and abundance vary within highway class? So we looked at the different road systems we have. We looked at interstates, US highways, and then state highway systems. And then how does maximum NDVI, or the normal difference vegetation index, play a role in that? So how does the greenness level, so it goes from a green, very green, to brown or no green, how does that index level play a part in that? And then what kind of floral richness and abundance do we need to sustain pollinators within the right of way, or help them through their process of egg laying and becoming adults? And how might these patterns inform our management practices and priorities for pollinators? So we set up transects. We have 63 transects that were set up, and we looked at the low NDVI, medium NDVI, and high NDVI. So low meaning the brown areas versus high meaning the greener areas. And then we looked at interstates, U.S. highways, and state highway systems. And that's our interstate system in the yellow. And then our U.S. highways in the blue, and our state highways in the orange. So we completed survey replicates from June and July in years 2021 and 2022. And late season subset of August 21 and 22. we did 100 meters transects, and we were collecting information on butterflies, bees, and flowering plants. We did pan trapping for the bees. So those are those little cups shown there. We set those up in different locations within each transect, and we collected bee data. And that was only done in the 2021 year, because when you collect the bees end up dying, because that's how you're going to collect them and identify them to find out what kind of bee species you have in a right of way, so, or any kind of research study. So we only did that in 2021. And then we looked, so part of that was looking at floral resources and looking at those different road systems in the NDVIs. And you can kind of see from these maps, if you're comparing floral resources between 2021 and 2022, 2022 had a lot more, like 10 times more floral resources and richnesses than in 2021. And that's because of our weather pattern. And if you remember in 2022, we had a really cold, wet spring. And it was like all over Idaho. It wasn't just in one place. It was like most of Idaho. So that kind of, we learned a little bit from that. And the results of the floral resources were, we had 87 flowering plant species that were documented within our right-of-ways. 48% of those were native, and the rest were non-native. So it's kind of half and half. So, you know, mostly widespread throughout the transects. We had a lot of non-native species, but they're predominantly these four in that are shown here. So of the native flowering plants that occurred, mostly native plants were occurring in the low to medium NDVI sites. So the lower, browner, drier looking sites were where the native plants were found, most of the native plants. And you can kind of tell in that high, when it had a high NDVI, which is the greener classes, like the class that was the most green, had the least amount of native plants in it. And I'm guessing because most of the plants that were green out there were alfalfa, mustards, and some of those plants that you're going to see. Well, we also found some unique native plants in our road systems. Who would have thought I would have found some of these really cool plants growing in a right-of-way of a road system? So you just never know. I mean, there's a whole lot of different plants out there, not just grasses, but some unique natives out there. So then we wanted to look at pollinator groups. And we looked at the two pollinators classes, the bees and the butterflies. So butterflies use plants that were available, including non-natives or natives. And you can kind of see from this slide that the majority of the road systems that we surveyed had non-natives, and the butterflies were utilizing those. I mean, that's what they had. It was either that or whatever's growing adjacent to our road system. So butterfly richness and butterfly abundance. So there were 38 different species of butterflies documented within our road systems. And this is just showing you kind of a side-by-side comparison of richness versus abundance. And they're kind of within those same road systems, they're kind of in there all over there. So butterfly richness increased significantly with floral abundance. It wasn't the other stuff, the NDVI or the road class system, but it depended on what types of flowering plants and the how many of them were out there. That's what the butterflies used. If there was a lot of flowering plants all at the same time and they had a variety, the butterflies were there. I mean, that's what they looked at, or that's what they were choosing. The butterflies didn't really care if it was a low NDVI brown site or versus a green site. They didn't care if it was heavily trafficked or versus low traffic. They cared if there was a lot of flowering plants out there. That's what the butterflies needed. That's what they were looking for. And that's what this data is kind of, our data showed. So butterfly species composition kind of depended on some of these other things. So, you know, the butterflies were, you know, if there was a lot of flowering plants, a lot of variety, that's where we had showed a lot more butterfly species. That's where we showed a lot of higher numbers. So low DVI or low greenness areas had some of the, they had more transects, more variation. There were more variation in butterfly species. But really what the butterflies focused on, if there were a lot of flowering plants, whether they're native or non-native, they were there. And then we wanted to look at some of the bees. So we wanted to know what kind of bees were out there, what were they looking for? Where were they most, you know, shown up more of? And this is a this is just two different maps showing you bee richness, bee abundance. So we saw, I had a slide in here. I think there was like 70 something bee species, but
it's on the last slide.
It was the last slide.
Yeah. It might be.
Oh, there it is. 70 taxa. So we found, you know, for driving along our road systems where you mostly see grass species, we found like 70 different bee species out there. And remember, the bee species were collected with those little cups. So that's how we knew. And we send all these to the Logan, Utah lab to identify down to species and everything. And we found 70 different species of bees out in our road system. I had no idea there were that many bees out there. I mean, you think about being, you know, agricultural fields and stuff, you would think, okay, that's where they're all at, but they were like going into our right of way still, next to agricultural fields, next to native habitats, next to, you know, weedy patches. The bees were still utilizing our right of ways, which was really cool. So bee richness was higher at the low NDVI or browner sites and along smaller road systems. So less traffic, less smaller, narrow right of ways and browner sites. That's where there were more bees at. And if you had flowering plants also in there, that was a benefit for the bees. They would just like attract to those things. So this is just more info on the NDVIs and the road systems. So bee species were a little bit more trickier than the butterflies. These bee species were varied a lot depending on the NDVI or the greener, browner class, highway class, and floral richness. Bees were a lot more all over the board when it comes to looking at them in relation to all those things. So pattern conclusions for patterns of species richness. So our pan trapping identified 70 species of bees. The NDVI, which is the greener versus browner, and our highway systems, traffic versus less traffic, can serve as spatial filters to help us identify areas for high bee richness and abundance. And the lower NDVI sites or smaller highways had significantly more bees and bee species. And if you think about bees, bumblebees, they kind of like those drier sites. They like bare soil. They like nesting areas. So that kind of makes a little bit more sense for the bees. And then native plants, lower disturbance and less toxin loads and more availability for nesting sites also help kind of identify these areas that the bees would be utilizing inter-road systems. So for butterflies, we found 38 species of butterflies. We found that the floral abundance and specific host plants are what drove the types of butterflies that were within our road systems or right-of-ways. The lower NDVI sites may host more unique butterfly communities, but the habitat specialists, while high NDVI sites may host more lower NDVI sites may host more unique butterfly communities with habitat specialists, while the high NDVI or greener sites may host more generalists. So that's one of the takeaways from the bees. And then on doing all of this research and stuff, we identified hot spots. And you can kind of see from this graph where those might be. And we circled those areas for both the bees and the butterflies. So this was like the most unique spot of all, which doesn't look like much. It looks like a lot of grass out there. We found over 191 bees and 21 bee species in this one site, in this one transect off this one site, which is located off of Highway 26. And it's, you can see on one side, it's mostly native or non-agricultural field habitat. And on the other side, you see, start seeing some of the agricultural circles in there. So why was this site so rich with all these? We don't know, because it was the only site that we had with all the 63 transects that produced this amount of species and abundance. All right, so from the study, we gathered all the information on the types of bees and the butterflies that utilize rest areas, the type of floral plants that we have. We wanted to know, what can we do to promote more pollinator beneficial habitat? So we looked at mowing, spraying, and restoration plantings. What can we do differently? What can we do to make this better for them? So thinking about roadside habitats and managing our road systems, pollinators need flower availability. They need host plant presence. They need nesting habitat. They need sources of water, and they need safety from threats. That's what pollinators need with whatever land that you're trying to restore, a land protecting for them. These are things that they need. So our best management practices for looking at promoting more pollinators was to look at our mowing regimes. So instead of mowing fence line to fence line in the middle of the summer, in the middle of the heightened pollinator migration and usage of plants, we're going to focus on mowing our clear zones, which is that first 10 to 20 feet from the edge of pavement, and leaving stuff beyond that for plants to continue the flowering cycle and their mature cycles. We're also considering looking at mowing or having narrower clear zones for smaller, less trafficked highways. So our state highway systems generally are very narrow compared to our interstates. So we're trying to figure out a good way to mow our clear zone or safety zone areas on less trafficked areas and leaving a space beyond that to the fence line. And these are just other kinds of data in there that we wanted to show. So mower width should be adjusted based on the right-of-way width itself. And having a narrower clear zone is beneficial for our smaller highway systems that don't have a wide right-of-way area. And then mowing activities, we're looking at doing between May 15th or before May 15th or after the end of September. So we're trying to figure out timing of mowing, when to mow, and how much to mow. And then where possible, we want to try to leave any perennial shrubs, any native vegetation, and standing woody stems alone and available, leaving those available for the nesting bees. And then for roadside spraying activities, we're looking at spot treating noxious weed patches rather than our blanket, just drive down the road system and spray out as far as you can spray. We want to target invasives or noxious weeds and avoid spraying the whole entire right away. And we want to limit products out there. So we want to target for specific plants and not just use anything like Roundup that would kill everything. Not that we do that, but you know, we're trying to work in the products for the specific plant species and timing those so that they're not killing everything out there, basically. Mm-hmm. And when we do that, we're trying to also keep. So the other part of this is looking at if it's flowering already, to just leave it alone and wait till it's done flowering, whether it's invasive, whether it's native or whatever. If it's producing a flower, pollinators are using that flower, whether it's a thistle, whether it's a sunflower, whether it's a penstemon. If it's flowering, pollinators are utilizing that. So we're trying to educate our folks to try to avoid spraying stuff when they're in full bloom and try to either target it before or after that. And then also educating them to leave the milkweed alone and not spray any of the milkweed that we have out there. And then for plantings, this research project talked about prioritizing plantings that would be furthest from the road system itself. So instead of planting right up next to the pavement or concrete or gravel, but maybe targeting our plantings with forbs, wildflowers, natives away from that road system, further away from that road system. So back towards the fence line or back from the ditch back of the right of way. And then it was also talked about considering planting, you know, areas that are next to native habitats. We have like road systems that are next to native habitats out there, next to public lands, next to areas that aren't being farmed or raising crops. So maybe we look at where our native systems are next to our right-of-ways and try to target planting our systems that kind of incorporate that. And then we already do this, but where we do seed after projects, whether it's construction or maintenance, we use native grass, native forbs, sometimes shrubs if there's slopes that we need to stabilize. So we're using native plants for that. And we're looking at, you know, smaller, narrower road systems with less traffic for plantings, or wanting to look at some of the higher NDVI sites could be a tool to identifying noxious weeds or invasive species or weed patches that we can target those places versus the lower NDVI sites. And then realizing that even our degraded roadsides, even roadsides that don't look like there's much out there, they host a lot of variety of bees and butterfly species out there. And whether they have milkweed plants, whether they have host specific plants, there's a lot of plants out there that pollinators are utilizing and they're beneficial. So sagebrush in our right-of-ways are still important to protect. We have to work with that, with the BLM and the fire and all that kind of stuff too. But sagebrush steppe is an important part of pollinators within our southern Idaho area. And we want to really keep as much of that intact if we can. And with that, that's all I have. Yes.
The site, the hotspot that's west of Pocatello.
Yes.
Did y'all measure for bare ground in your transects? Because I imagine with a lot of native bees being ground nesting, that the percentage of bare ground within a patch might be like really important for
it was nesting. Was important. It wasn't measured. It was noted because of the NDVI part of our project looked at brown versus green. And so those areas that were brown had more bare spots. And so those bare spots or the brownness of an area kind of represented areas where the bees or the bumblebees were ground nesting bees would have occurred more.
Right. I just imagine like phenologically, Bromus tectorum like could also show really low on NDVI during like a certain time of the year.
Correct.
And could be if you just use NDVI as a proxy for bare ground, what looks like bare ground could be just a big patch of cheatgrass.
True. That could be. We were manually out there, so it was noted, I guess you might say, in the notes, but it wasn't specifically measured for no plant growth, no plant there, other than it was noted there was bareness, but it wasn't a specific requirement, I guess, for this part of the research. We were just trying to figure out, is there a difference between the green sites versus brown sites? We did notice or took into consideration there were areas with Bromus tectorum versus sand or in that, but it wasn't in that whole, it wasn't one of the requirements that we had to measure for, I guess. Yes. You.
Oh, me?
Yes.
Okay.
I don't know your name.
Yeah, so I'm actually an entomologist, and I have a lot of thoughts about this, but I'm maybe infamously fairly skeptical and critical of the monarch conservation initiatives, mostly because the monarch butterfly, while it may be declining in our region, is ultimately a cosmopolitan species that is probably unlikely to go extinct anytime soon. Relative to the abundance of local native endemic species that only occur in the Western United States that are not being paid attention to because they're oftentimes obscure and go under the radar, unlike monarch butterfly, which is very charismatic and attractive. And I'm somewhat concerned that the effect of planting milkweed doesn't have much benefit to species outside of monarch and the very specific suite of arthropods that feed on milkweed, which are also generally very widely distributed. And as far as I know, none of them are endemic to Idaho. So one thing that I would be curious to see if you looked at, and I'm guessing you probably didn't, but maybe it would be easy to think about, is did you ever look at whether or not milkweed presence correlated negatively or positively with pollinator abundance and richness in any of these sites too? Because that's something I'm somewhat concerned about and would be interested in looking at to see if the milkweed plantings are actually hurting other species besides the monarch by essentially acting as a weed, a noxious weed, even though they're native, many of them. I think that they provide less ecosystem benefits than other native species that could be in their place instead. So I was just curious if that was maybe something that you thought about, or maybe you'd notice any trends like that at all with areas that were high in milkweed, whether or not they might have had more or less bee and butterfly abundance besides monarchs.
So let's see if I can restate that. So does presence or absence of milkweed plants specifically have a negative or positive influence on other pollinators?
Yeah, and specifically sites where maybe milkweed has been intentionally planted, or I don't know if you guys are doing that or not, but especially sites like that, or even just sites where they occur in large numbers naturally. Like you said, there's a few hot spots like around Idaho Falls.
Right. So we documented presence of milkweed within the right-of-way systems We generally haven't planted milkweed in the past. So these would have been populations of milkweed that occurred in the right-of-way system already, so to speak. We haven't, or we didn't within this research study, correlate there that with whether there was any negative or positive influence for other types of insects specifically, because we were mainly trying to figure out, one, where was the milkweed plants to begin with, because we know that that's the main host plant for the monarch, and two, what other flowering plants do we have that are attractive for pollinator species in general. So I don't have the information on whether there was a negative impact or positive impact for other species for just milkweed, other than what's already utilizing milkweed, like the beetles and things that we showed. What I can tell you is that our road systems, there's a lot of road systems that don't have any milkweed, but they're relying on pollinators in general, relying on anything else flowering, whether that be invasive or native. So we had, I don't know if you noticed this year, this year was the first year that our maintenance crews were told not to mow or spray out flowering plants. And so there was like an overabundance of sunflowers out there. like everywhere you drove, there was yellow everywhere. I mean, like the medians, the everywhere. And not that's not a bad thing. I mean, I did get calls and concerns from all sorts of people, but I don't know if you know this, but like for Idaho, so Southern Idaho, just get off a little bit of a tangent. For right-of-ways, there's not a lot of plants out there that will flower from mid to late summer to fall. There's four species that we would have in our right-of-ways, sunflower being one of them, rabbit brush being another one. Tansy aster, and then goldenrod. There's four species out of everything out there that would occur or be useful for pollinators in general for late season. That's it. And so anyway, to get back to your question, I am interested in know whether there's negative impacts for having milkweed there, but for our road systems, that when you look at the whole broader sense, there's a lot of area that has that can have a potential for other flowering plants to benefit other pollinator species besides monarchs out there. So I'd be still interested to know whether there's a negative impact out there, but we didn't, for this particular study, we didn't capture that.
Can I just toss in another way to look at it possibly is you find the milkweeds in the greenest spots where we've already determined is where we find the fewest that are pollinating. So it's just, you know, there's going to be a separation there no matter what.
Yeah. Thank you.
I have a question from online, and maybe we just missed it at the very beginning, but we're focusing on Southern Idaho, and David said, was there no milkweed found in Northern Idaho, US 95?
So yes, there is milkweed in other parts of Idaho. I know that because I drive it a lot. this particular study we had, you have time, which is a 2-year focus, and you have money. Mm-hmm. And the reason we focused on the Southern Idaho is because we know that's the migration pattern for the monarch butterfly when it comes into Idaho. It always comes in through the southern part, and it scatters from the southern part into these other areas. But it's been documented that's their main migration route is the Snake River Plain. And so that's where we focused our study. Yes.
Did you ever look at how soil characteristics affects the milkweed, such as is the soil acidic or basic, or what soil conditions really makes for good milkweed populations?
So a question was, is have we looked at the soil attributes or characteristics with milkweed and how the milkweed works or grows within? And we did not collect that with that. For this particular study, we didn't look at the soil components on what types of soils are better for milkweed. And I can tell you, I haven't done soil samples, which would be a good thing to do. I've seen milkweed growing on our right-of-way systems right up to the edge of pavement, and there's no water there. You know, it's maybe the plant's only yay big, you know, 2 feet tall, but it's growing in places where there's no water, and that's growing in places where it collects more water, like in a depression or a ditch or something within our road systems, and then up against a fence line to an agricultural field. So it would be interesting to know if there's specific soil components that are more apt to produce more milkweed plants, but we didn't get a chance to look at that with this study. Yes.
I have another one from Christine online. Can Joey milkweed be successfully transplanted? There are several large patches along Highway 44, West State Street near Glenwood in Garden City.
It can be transplanted. I've transplanted some. It takes some, I don't know if there's, how do I put it? It can be successfully transplanted and grown. It can be grown from seed or it can be transplanted as a plant, because I've done it, but I haven't quite figured out the right, whatever it needs to get it going the best, but it can be done transplanting it. It can be done with seed. There's some literature out there. I think the Plant Materials Center in Aberdeen's done some research on growing milkweed plants and the best methods or ways to do that. And I know there's some other literature out there because I printed out stuff to figure out how to make that work better. Me personally, I just know it works. I just don't know the best method to do it because I've tried it all. I've tried it both with seeds that I've dug up and replanted it into a pot versus and into a flower bed area, and it worked. But, so. Yes.
What's the highway risks of not mowing at all? Like, is that even an option?
Oh, what are the highway risks for not mowing? For southern Idaho, it would be fire, because we have a lot of fire starts within road systems or adjacent to road systems that incorporate road systems. So cheatgrass, Medusa head, all those flammable grasses that are out there. If there are any inklings of other good stuff out there in mixed, if we have a fire, it's all gone. So not mowing for a road system, you have several factors. We mow because of site distance. So keeping vegetation at a reasonable level that people can safely leave the pavement out into an area that can see wildlife approaching the road system. We mow because there's areas where there's snow drifting effects, and so lower vegetation keeps that snow from piling up on the road itself and the adjacent to the road, and then the fire part. So those are factors we have to consider when we mow. We're trying to get our folks to concentrate into that 15 feet or so from the edge of pavement where we know we have site distances, we know we have fire starts, we know we have snow drifting, and to concentrate that instead of all the way to the fence line. Because I think there's benefits from having vegetation growing to their mature stature, whether it's a wildflower, sagebrush, or grass. There's benefits to having that. I mean, there's a lot of benefits for having them continue their reproductive cycle. But to weigh that with safety and cars and impacts to cars if they leave the road system, all that plays a part. Yes.
Yeah, a couple of questions for you. One is, where is the rest area you mentioned that had a native plant garden? We want to go see it.
Oh, so it would be our westbound Bliss rest area. Mm-hmm. The question was, where is the rest area that has a native pollinator garden? It's our westbound Bliss rest area, which is between Mountain Home and Twin Falls area. So we're just east of Glens Ferry. And it's the westbound, so it's on the north side of the interstate. There's a little area we planted a bunch of native plants in, and we put in some, we put in a like a drip system to get them started. I don't think that drip system's worked now for 2 years, but anyway, there's a lot of plants out there. The issues we have with that is I can't seem to organize our guys to go in and weed it at the beginning of the season. So that it does look kind of overgrown or weedy after, you know, certain times of the year. So I go out every chance I get driving through that hole, that back and forth to Pocatello or Idaho Falls, and try to weed some. So I'm still working on that part of getting it back to what it should look like instead of what it is. But that's where our native plant or pollinator garden is. It has a variety of different plants from it does have milkweed, but it also has a lot of different flowering plants of pedestemons and some other intermountain species for this area. So it's worth looking at. It may not be the best manicured part. So, yeah.
And then the second question was, where the noxious weeds are being treated, like big patches of noxious weeds, is there an effort for ITD to put back natives in hopes that they'll keep the noxious weeds down or out, you know, to prevent future invasions?
Yes, I've been, question was, is there a effort for ITD to put back natives in places where they're removing or eliminating some of the noxious weeds or invasive species? And yes, where we can remove or eliminate noxious weeds, invasive species, if there's a place where it's more open or barren or whatever, yes, we have seed to go back into those sites to get those hopefully reestablished with something better and beneficial. It doesn't always happen in the right time, but we do have seed and programs in place to get something back in there so something else doesn't come in that we don't want. Yes.
Yeah, I just want to take off on the rest area thing again. Advocate for, how about more of the rest areas also for reserves for native plant habitat, not just what's planted, but what's already there, managed and allowed to be there, and even have an interpretive walk through that so that when people get out, they can admire and appreciate.
Yes. I am totally on that. I would love that. Yes. We are advocating and looking at all of our rest areas. If there's projects where we have some rehab work or some repairs or some way of doing some kind of work at a rest area, we're trying to look at that. So we have two other rest areas that they haven't been done yet, but there's two other rest areas we're looking at putting in xeriscape natives pollinator garden type, and that's the Snake River View rest area out off of I-84 on the Oregon Idaho border, and then the North Blackfoot rest area just near Blackfoot, Idaho. Both of those locations where they have had the lawn or the irrigation system that we have is not good, and it can't keep up with the lawn, can't keep up with the watering. And so the lawns are dying off. And so we want to replace those with something else more natural, more xeriscape, more in that.
I'm even more interested in, rather than rehabbing something that's already been altered, to the extent that you can allow the native vegetation that has already been there to persist and enhance. That's where you get more.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, rather than feeling you need to go in and bulldoze and change the whole thing in the first place.
Yeah, right.
Is there ways to just kind of leave the intact stuff there as public access to explore?
Yes, there should be a way to leave intact stuff as long as it's not like more noxious invasive type, where we'd have to want to go in and get rid of that part to make it something that's close enough to a native.
I'm disappointed when I'm driving through with some native hats, but I'd like to get out and see yes. the rest area pull over, and it's completely modified up to the fence.
Yeah. So our North Blackfoot rest area that's near the eastern side of the state near Blackfoot, that actually has some trails through the lava fields and it has native vegetation that's just natural how it grows. It's what it is out there. We haven't done anything with that. So there are some places where we can do that. And then there's places where it's invasive or something that we just need to do something different that we don't want that there either. Yes.
All right. Online, we have Kate asking, are there any national policies for pollinator and native plant management for highway right of way that states are to also follow?
Are there national policies or procedures or funding or something?
Yeah, for pollinators or native plant management.
There is. There's like different transportation bills and other things that have a native component, native plant component to that, but it's also tied with removing or eradicating noxious weeds and invasive species, and it's also tied with all sorts of other, it's not just by itself, I guess is what I would say. There are components for that, for funding for these types of things, but it competes with other stuff that's within that bill or what funding mechanism. So yes, there is. And hopefully we can tie into some of those. Yes.
It's kind of wild, but I think near Snowville, there's a rest area.
Yes.
That's got a lot of, I think it's the furthest northern stand of the Utah juniper.
Juniper, yes.
And that might seem to be a pretty good, it's higher elevation.
Yes.
But I don't think that's been really that much modified.
No, you are correct. There is a rest area on Interstate 84 heading south going into Utah, and it's called Juniper Rest Area because of the juniper species there. And it has a lot of juniper tree species, bunch grasses, and there's a lot of natural habitat within that and paths that go through there. We don't have anything signed or any kind of a nature garden kind of thing that has any kind of information about the types of species or what occurs there, but there is a lot of native habitat within that area that we've left alone. So there are some places like that. Not every rest area has that option, but where there is that, we try to keep that. So,
yeah. All right, I have one more online. What is your goal for monarch milkweed habitat, and how short are we in reaching that goal?
What is our goal for monarch habitat and reaching that goal? Well, at this stage, I would say our objective is to know what we have out there already. And to protect what we have out there already and try to leave it alone so that pollinators can utilize it. And then from that, any project that we have that our road system is under construction for whatever it means, widening, adding lanes, realignment, or whatever, we include a pollinator plant component for our seed mixes, which could be milkweed if it's in the right locations. It could be native flowering plants like penstemons, yarrows, or in our southern Idaho, it could be glow mallow. It could be a lot of different flowering plants that pollinators would utilize, so a native flowering component, and hopefully that continues on for x years forward.
Meeting with a forested and smooth loan, or is that being phased out?
Nope, that's being phased out.
Is it totally done?
It's not totally done, I would say, because I'm not the one that gets to prescribe every seed mix for every project. Although that's my role, but not everybody seeks to know what they should use in a seed mix. So a private design firm could put in whatever mixes they want, seed mixes or seed species that they've used in the past, so to speak, but if it comes through me, we're phasing that out. So no smooth brome, no crested. We're going to more slender wheats, to blue bunch wheatgrass, fescues, and those kinds of things.
Are you guys having trouble finding enough seed for all the native borers and flowers?
Yes and no. We used to have a lot of different vendors that can supply native seed, grasses, and forbs. And those vendors, I don't know if they're just not able to provide the amount that we need for projects, or if the seed vendors there's been one that I know of that's kind of like, yeah, we don't want to work with you guys. We're just going to do our own. We're going to supply it to somebody else, and that person can supply it to you. I don't know why, but so it's a hit and miss on that.
We'll see you all next year. Thanks, that was great. Oh, really.